And you make it a company's husband. Guilty.
Sat here with the cats. So a lot of people ask me on YouTube and Instagram how I maintain my motivation to recover. So they say, like, I know I don't want to be ill anymore, but when I come to do the things I need to do, I can't do it. There's like a mental block. So maybe you had like a New Year's resolution, like 2019 is going to be the year that I'm going to recover. But then a few weeks into the year, you find you're still like stuck in the same old behaviours. You can't follow through with your desire to change. So cute. I've so been there with this, honestly. I can remember examples from my recovery when I like had this wave of like, I've had enough, that's it. Like, I'm gonna change. I know what I want to do. Like, I remember at the start of this relapse, I went and got my bones tested and I got a phone call to tell me I have osteoporosis. I was 29 and I had this huge wave of like, what the fuck am I actually doing to my body? And I was with Brendan at the time, we were in the car, and I was like, take me to Baskin Robbins right now. I was like, I need calcium, I need to gain weight, I'm gonna go and get a massive ice cream. And I walked in so determined and so concerned for my health until I got to the ice cream counter, and then I was like, I can't do it. Oh my God, it's too many calories, it's not a planned snack time, it's more than I'd usually have, I'm gonna gain weight, I'm gonna get fat. Even though I walked into the place thinking, right, I need to gain weight, I need to gain weight. When I got to the food, I was like, I can't have that, it'll make me gain weight. What? Or like, also, when I was 14 and I was getting ill, I didn't used to weigh myself at all when I was getting ill. Like, I actually had no intention whatsoever really to lose weight, weirdly. And then one day I stood on the bathroom scales and I was shocked by my weight, like absolutely horrified. I couldn't believe how much weight I'd lost. And I was like, Meg, you need to sort this out. This is ridiculous. Like, you're 14, you can't weigh that. But then I went downstairs to have breakfast and whatever, and I couldn't increase what I was eating. It's so weird, but I think it's like really easy to want to recover away from food and weight gain. But when you're faced with the actual threat of that and like what you actually need to do to recover, it's like a completely different story. And you can have all the best intentions in the world, but yeah, faced with the real threat and like the actual action of what you need to do, those intentions just go out the window. Oh, Stevie, look at her. So I'd always find that like my automatic thoughts would kick in when I was around food. And it always felt like a good idea to try and like miss calories or lose weight. Like, oh, take the stairs instead of the lift so you can burn more calories. And then in the same way, weight gain felt like a threat, like, oh, don't put oil in the pan when you're cooking, you'll gain weight. Don't have that ice cream, you'll gain weight. Even though I went into the ice cream shop being like, right, I need to gain weight, faced with the ice cream, I was like, oh, I can't have it, I'll gain weight. Sometimes I would like look at myself and see myself as too skinny and be like, that looks horrible, Meg, go and gain some weight, get to the food, and then be like, I can't eat that food, it'll make me gain weight. Like, it's like a total disconnect between what I'm trying to do, my intentions, and then my behaviours and how I feel when it actually like comes to doing the thing I need to do. Also, the thoughts are always so believable when they pop in, and they're so automatic that it just used to get me, like, still does sometimes, get me really confused. Like, what am I actually trying to do here? Like, am I trying to miss calories and lose weight? Am I trying to gain weight? Am I too skinny? Have I already had too much today? Have I already gained weight? Like, ugh. And as soon as I got rid of one thought, like argued it away, another one would pop up straight away. So if I was like making a sandwich, I'd try and put mayonnaise on the bread, and then it'd be like, oh, don't do that, it's too many calories. And then I'd be like, no, it's a normal thing to do, like I'm trying to gain weight. And then I'd think, oh, but you've already gained weight this week, like miss the mayonnaise now. And I'd be like, no, like that's an abnormal behavior. Don't miss the mayonnaise, put it on. And then my head would be like, oh, but you're going out for dinner later, like save the calories now, miss the mayonnaise and you can have something else later. Like, it was just such a jumble of thoughts and like an actual battleground in my head trying to negotiate between like automatic thoughts popping up and me trying to argue them down, but then I kind of believe them at the same time, so maybe I should listen to this thought, like, ugh. And then I'd end up getting stuck in the kitchen for ages because I'd be like paralyzed by all these thoughts in my head and not actually knowing what I needed to do and what my goal was, what was right, what was real. Ugh. Right, I'm just gonna go make a cup of tea. How cool is the fridge door, by the way? Love it. So I've sat on the floor because she'd stolen my seat, but... So I think I was saying that I've definitely struggled with this too, like translating your motivation into action. It was never just decide to change and that was it, go out and do it. Like, I don't think you can decide yourself out of anorexia or eating disorders. Right, nutcase? One thing that's helped me quite a lot is to think about like why that actually happens. I kind of see my eating disorder almost like a habit. Like for years and years, I've practiced it. So I've taken the stairs, I've avoided cooking with oil, I've had a Diet Coke instead of a milkshake, I've chosen the lowest calorie option, whatever. Like it's not gonna be easy for me to just suddenly one day stop. And also like more than just a habit, it's like a proper phobia really, like a fear of eating more than however many calories or gaining weight, being in a healthy body, whatever your phobia might be, like eating certain ingredients, eating at certain times, eating food prepared in a certain way. Like you can't just decide to not be scared of something anymore. Like people with a fear of spiders don't just decide to not be scared of spiders. It can't just be a New Year's resolution, you know, like, oh, it's 2019 now, I'm just not gonna have my fear of spiders anymore. Like, no, because it's in your brain, like you still have a fear. And my psychologist has done so much work with me to get me to like expose myself to my fears and realize that the thing I'm scared of happening doesn't happen. Or that it does happen, but it's actually not as awful as I thought it was gonna be and I can actually cope or learn other ways to cope, whatever. So if you've got a fear of like house spiders because you're scared they're gonna crawl on you, like that actually might happen. Like if you're exposed to a spider, it might crawl on you, but actually that's fine. Like you can have a spider crawl on you and nothing bad will happen. So like the outcome of your fear actually isn't as bad as you thought it was gonna be and like you can tolerate it and learn to cope with it. One of my fears was if I ate right before I went to bed, I would immediately balloon up and it would stick to me overnight and yeah, I'd gain a shit ton of weight overnight. And then through like exposure to that, I realized, okay, that actually doesn't happen. And now if I'm hungry before I go to bed, I'll normally eat some chocolate. Like I'm not really scared of that now. But then another fear for me was that if I let myself eat unrestricted and eat everything that I want to eat, that I'll gain weight and that I'll become a healthy weight. And that's a weird one because like that has happened for me. Eating unrestricted means that I have gained weight and I can't eat unrestricted and maintain a BMI of like 20 because it's not my body's natural BMI. So if I'm listening to my body and my hunger cues and my extreme hunger and my cravings and eating what I actually want to eat, I will not be a BMI 20. So that's kind of like exposure where the thing I'm scared of has happened, but now I'm like, well, it's actually not as bad as I expected it to be, honestly. Being like in a healthy BMI isn't as terribly awful. Some days it is, but some days it's okay. But I'm actually like trying to find new ways to cope and adapt and like move on to other things in life kind of thing. So I don't know if I've made much sense with that, but my psychologist basically says like, if you avoid the thing you're scared of, then your belief remains unchallenged. I also kind of think about the neural wiring in your brain. Like your brain is literally programmed around your beliefs and habits and fears, eating disorder behaviors. You literally practice these things every day. So your brain doesn't know that it's 2019. So you've made a New Year's resolution to take a different behavior now. Like when you're faced with these things that you've been avoiding and that you've been scared of, you're facing them with your old neural network in place. So never mind 2019's resolution, like your brain doesn't know that. It just knows, okay, I'm scared of this thing, I've been avoiding this thing, or I've been doing this behavior. So it's not one day just gonna quickly make the switch because you've decided you want a better life than that. And it's helped me so much to think, like, there's not actually anything wrong with me. I'm not doing it wrong when I come to do the thing I want to do and can't do it. Like, that's actually really, really understandable. And it kind of shows that, like, motivation on its own isn't enough, or, like, intention on its own isn't enough. You literally have to do it. Like, it's only actions that are going to get you unscared of your fears, breaking habits, rewiring your brain, deprogramming all the eating disorder that you've built up over potentially years. Like, for me, it was years. So yes, a New Year's resolution isn't going to do all that. Learning that I've got osteoporosis and that I need to improve my health and my weight isn't going to do that. Seeing myself as too skinny, or seeing a number on the scale and thinking, fucking hell, that's ridiculous, gain weight. Like, none of these life experiences in themselves are actually going to make me recover. It's like, yeah, it's just action. Like, I have to do it myself through, like, repeated action. So I think Brendan's going to be home in a minute, and we're going to make some lunch together. He's been at football this morning. Right, Brendan's just messaged to say he's finished football and he's on his way home. And did I want a coffee? Obviously it's not a planned coffee, but I'm really trying to think, like, a coffee's just a coffee. It's not food, it's not a number, it's not something that needs to be substituted or worked into my day. And he's also going to pick up chicken, we've got some cheese, we've got some wraps, and we're going to make some toasties.
One of the famous in my daylight. Are you making a coffee's husband? Guilty.
People do love you.
You can start.
No, you cut it. I need you to decide the size.
Look at that. Same as this.
Thank you. Fine that I had a spontaneous coffee? Yes, it's fine.
Hi.
I know, and I don't want to watch you have coffees and me just be jealous that you've got it, or watch you eat nice wraps and say,
fuck that, you're all mate.
I know.
You can be dead.
The wing's my bit of the picking chicken.
Some cob.
It's amazing when it's done like
that. I'm not going full cob.
I can hear the cheese.
I think we're done.
Okay, let's go. Level stuff. Ah, oh, gutted. Ready? I'm just editing this week's video, and a thought that's really helped change my recovery is realizing that, like, it's okay to still get automatic eating disorder thoughts. Like, you will for a period because your brain is still completely wired around them. But I think the thing that really helped me was realizing, like, just because I get the thoughts doesn't mean I need to act on them. And it's really difficult because you have to, like, consistently do recovery actions, but with a brain that's still wired around an eating disorder. But, like, over time, with repetition and doing the opposite actions and, like, the non-eating disorder behaviours, like, your brain will relearn and rewire, but it needs, like, exposure to be able to do that. And it's not quick as well. Like, think how many, maybe years, you've spent practicing eating disorder behaviours and teaching your brain a certain thing. Like, it's not suddenly just gonna be unscared of your fear foods. And yeah, it has helped me to think, like, of course it's going to take a while. Like, I need to be patient. I'm basically trying to deprogram and rewire my brain. So, like, it's not going to be immediate. So at first, like, yes, I'll still get my eating disorder thoughts popping up because that's how my brain's wired. But if I act on them, I'm just going to strengthen my eating disorder neural pathways and I'll always have those thoughts. So it's through, like, opposite actions that you're training your brain, like down a different path. You're creating a new neural network. You're deprogramming all the eating disorder you've learned over years. Yeah, I think that's all I really wanted to say. Like, getting the automatic eating disorder thoughts is normal, like it's completely understandable, but just because you get them doesn't mean they're real, doesn't mean you need to act on them. And if you do act on them, you're just keeping yourself trapped in your eating disorder. So I guess shout out to opposite actions and just actions in general, to be honest. Like, we can't think ourselves out of eating disorders. We can't decide ourselves out of them. Like, it literally has to be actions. So you can't think like, oh, I'd do it if I didn't feel guilty, or I can't eat that because it will make me feel so frustrated. Like, no, not really. Like, you can't really wait until you feel comfortable. So lots of love to everyone, and I'll speak to you soon.